Amen. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2. Last week we started the series that we've been looking at all year on the saturation of the Word, and our theme verse is on the posters up there. Be filled with the glory of the Lord. Be filled with the glory of the Lord. Be filled with the glory of the Lord. To be filled with His presence as the waters cover the sea. We need to be filled with His presence. I ask you, why did you come to church today? Why did you leave your nice, warm snuggies? Why did you get out of your nice, warm bed and go out into that zero-degree weather to come to church? I almost didn't want to get out of my warm snuggies and come to church today. Why do we come to church? What do we want when we gather together? Why do we read the Word? Why do we pray? Why do we worship? Why do we sing? Is it just the thing to do and we just go through the motions? Or does God want to do something dynamic and daring in our life? God wants us in these last days not to just go through the motions, but He wants us to live a life that is dynamic in the power of the Holy Spirit. See, why do we do what we do on Sunday? Why do we worship? Why do we sing? Why do we give? Why do we serve? Why do we worship? Why do we do what we do? What is the benefit of what we do? What are we looking for in our church? What do we want out of ICC? My prayer is that we will be a church that is saturated with the presence of the Holy Spirit, and that in our individual lives and as we gather together, we will sense His presence. Not just feel it once in a while, but to live in the presence of the Holy Spirit. See, priorities change when you're in the presence of the living God. Our ideas change, our lives change, our marriages change, our families change when we come into the presence of the living God. You cannot come into the presence of the living God and still be the same way. Can I have an amen? I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2. We began in Acts 1 last week talking about how Jesus says, it's for your advantage that I go away. If I go away, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. He saw 500 people saw Him when He rose from the dead. 120 went to the upper room. They obeyed Him. 380 disobeyed Him. 380 did their own thing. They missed out on the obedience to God's Word. And if you want the blessing of God, you need to be obedient to God. And so the 120 go to the upper room, and we pick it up in Acts chapter 2 and beginning at verse 1. It says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all together in one place in one accord. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, as one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Boy, that sounds so unnatural. In the natural mind, we can't understand what's going on. We want to just skirt over. It sounds like something on a TV show or on a sci-fi movie, and this is something, man, we don't understand it, so we don't even want to look at it. And verse 5 says, and there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused because everyone heard them speak in their own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, look, are not all those who speak Galileans? Jump down to verse number 12, and we read there. So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, whatever could this mean? Others mocking said, they are full of new wine. There were people who looked at what these new Christians were doing, who were baptized in the Holy Spirit. They says, man, they're drunk. They're too happy. They're too joyous. They're talking in a different language. But verse 14, but Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, Let this be known to you and heed my words, for these are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Aren't you glad? He's still pouring out his spirit on all flesh. If you still have flesh, he's pouring out his spirit. He says your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see vision. I pray that our young men, that means anybody who is younger than me is young. That means that you're still seeing visions. Visions that God wants to give to you. Not your own vision, but visions that come from the Lord. He says that your old men shall dream dreams. That means you never get too old for the need of the Holy Spirit in your life. We need the Holy Spirit in our lives. And on my men servants and on my maid servants, on men and women, I'll pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. I'll show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. We need the Holy Spirit in our lives. How in the world can we live a spiritual life without the Holy Spirit? How can we live a spiritual life without the one that makes us holy, the one that makes us righteous, the one that equips us and empowers us? And God says, it's for your advantage that I go away, because if I go away, I will send the Comforter. And in Acts chapter 2, it says, and when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one accord. The 120, as we looked at last week, they were in the upper room. They were there out of obedience. They were there with expectation that, God, I don't know what's going to happen, but Lord, you gave us a promise and we're going to expect it. We're going to walk in obedience to you. They were in prayer. They were in unity. And it was on the day of Pentecost. Now, let me give you a little background to what that really means. Pentecost was a feast that was held 50 days after the Feast of the First Fruits. Pentecost comes from the Greek word, which means 50. And every Jewish man would have to take his family and make the trek to Jerusalem for three major feasts every year. And these three major feasts represent what Jesus Christ has done in our life. First of all, the first feast was the Feast of Passover. That goes back to the Old Testament when the death angel was coming. And Moses told them that you need to take the lamb, you need to take the blood and put it over the doorpost. And when the death angel sees you, the death angel will pass over you. See, that is a representation of what Jesus Christ has done. Just like the enemy couldn't kill those children. Friends, when Jesus Christ is applied to your heart and the blood is applied to your life, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of the testimony. He is saying that victory is ours because of Jesus Christ, and no weapon formed against us shall prosper. And there is a feast of the Passover, and Jesus wants us to know that he died on the cross for all of our sins, and that there is no weapon, there is no enemy, there is nothing that can take your soul from him, because we are covered by the blood of the Jesus. But I think too many Christians don't understand what it really means to be saved. Oh, we say, yeah, we go to church. But friends, when I am saved, I am covered by the blood of the Lamb. I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am protected by the blood of the Lamb. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And there's still power in the blood of Jesus for those who walk in obedience to him. But then there was the Feast of the Tabernacles, and that was the first fruit. It represents the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It represented life. I'm so glad Jesus still isn't on the cross. I'm so glad he's still not in the tomb, but he rose on the third day so that we can have life and have it more abundantly. And friends, no matter what the enemy whispers to you, that you're no good and you can't amount to anything, the power of the resurrection, I know that my Redeemer lives, and we need to walk in the resurrection power. Easter is not just one day a year. You know, we're going to celebrate the last Sunday of March, and we say, he lives, he lives. Let me tell you, Jesus lives today. He lives tomorrow. He lives when the doctor gives you bad news. He loves you, and he lives within you, and all hell breaks loose against your life, because the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead now dwells within us. And then there was the Feast of Pentecost, which was the birth of the church. It was when the church really got its existence, and Pentecost is more than just a feast, but on the day of Pentecost, it was a time of celebration. Friends, the church should be the best place to celebrate anywhere in the world. Why do we leave it to the ballroom to celebrate? Why do we leave it to the disco to celebrate? Why doesn't the Church of Jesus Christ celebrate the goodness of our good, good Father who has given us everything we need? Can I have an amen? Friends, we have a reason to celebrate, because I was once lost, but now I am found. I was once defeated, but now I walk in victory. I was once a sinner, but now I'm a saint. I have a reason to celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's a time of great joy. The saturated church is a church that knows the joy of the Lord, because the joy of the Lord is our strength. Why do we have so many weak Christians today? It's because they haven't known the joy that comes from the Holy Spirit, righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. And when you walk in the joy of the Lord, friends, there is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, another reason why we should celebrate and rejoice is because Pentecost was a rejoicing over the heart. The harvest that God gave to them, the food that God provided for them, which is a symbol that God is saying, you look on the harvest field, for it's ripe under harvest. He is referring to the power and the saturation of the Holy Spirit is for those who have a heart for lost people. The sad truth is 90 to 98% of Christians never lead anybody to the Lord Jesus Christ. I'll say it so bluntly in love this morning. I don't need the Holy Spirit if I don't have a heart for lost people outside the doors. I don't need the Holy Spirit to come and to sit and to sing songs and go through the motions. But when I begin to have a heart and a passion and a burden for lost people and my unsaved loved ones and my family members that are away from God and the people that I work with, then I need the saturation of the Holy Spirit. Friends, churches that stop reaping the harvest are not saturated with the Holy Spirit. See, if we're not caring about the lost, we might as well close the church and go home now, because it's not about us. It's not about putting the big show on Sunday and making people feel good and say, man, look what the church can do for me. It's about reaching lost and dying people. For God's word says, all the angels in heaven rejoice when one soul that comes to Jesus Christ. The day of Pentecost, the priest would take two loaves of bread and they would wave them before the Lord. And it was a sign of the goodness of God for his bountiful supply to his people. Pentecost was the birth of the church. It was the initiation. It was what was needed for the church to start then, and it's needed for the church today as well. See, what is the Holy Spirit? Why do I need it? Look in your outline quickly this morning. Pentecost was a prophetic experience. A prophetic experience. What does that mean? Pentecost was not a shock or a surprise to anybody that knew the Bible. It was not a shock to God. It was not a shock to the early Christians. Pentecost was not an afterthought. It was an expectation. If you would read the Old Testament, you would see how many times that it was prophesied that the Holy Spirit was going to be outpoured in the last days. It says in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 23, in the King James Version, I will pour out my Spirit on you. In Isaiah 44, verse 33, Isaiah prophesied about the coming of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. He says, I will pour water upon those who are thirsty, and I will flood upon the dry ground. That if I'm thirsty, he says, I will pour out my Spirit on. If you're not thirsty, guess what? He won't pour out your Spirit. Oh God, I pray, let us realize how thirsty we need to be. We read in Acts chapter 2, it was a prophecy from Joel chapter 2, and afterwards, I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my Spirit in those last days. I'm so glad we're living in the last days, and God says, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. That means here, that means in Staten Island, that means in ICC, and it means today. For it says in Zechariah 4:6, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. Oh, everybody wants the church to do this and have program. Let me tell you, we need the presence of God. And when we have Spirit-saturated meetings and powerful prayer meetings, God will begin to work and to change the hearts and the lives of people. But it was not only a prophetic experience in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament. It says in Matthew 3:11, I baptize with water, but Jesus will come and will what? baptize you in the Holy Spirit and with fire. Jesus prophesied in Acts 1:5, John truly baptized with water, but you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit. The baptism, the Holy Spirit, was not a surprise. Friends, Jesus spent the vast majority of the book of John talking about who he was and that it was for my advantage that you go away because he will send the Holy Spirit. Turn over to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. And I hope you have your Bibles and you write these notes down and these words, these verses down and read them later. John chapter 14 and verse 15, he gives an extended teaching over the next three chapters about the Holy Spirit. He says in verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. And if I keep his commandments, verse 16, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, capital H is the Holy Spirit, that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. Friends, if you're not right with God, you will never see him. You will never sense his presence. You will never be able to be saturated with the presence of God until Jesus comes to live and dwell within you. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you orphans, I will come to you. A little while longer and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you will live also. At that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will be loved by him and manifest myself in him. Jump down to verse 25. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things. How many need God to lead and teach you some things? And bring to you your remembrance all things that I have said. Peace, I leave. How many need some peace in their lives? You can't have peace unless you have the presence and the person of the Holy Spirit living. Peace, I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You have heard me saying to you, I am going away and coming back to you. If you love me, you would rejoice because I said, I'm going to the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe. Oh, turn over to chapter 15, verses 26 and 27. And I'm going to read it out of the English Standard Version. And it says it this way, but when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. The Holy Spirit is always going to lead you back to Jesus and to the Word of God. The Holy Spirit will never lead you somewhere else. He will never lead you to do something contrary to the Word of God. He won't say, well, you know, it's okay for you to leave your husband or wife and go shack up with somebody. That's never of the Holy Spirit. Oh, a lot of Christians, well, I feel God's leading me to do it. If it's contrary to the Word of God, it is not the Holy Spirit. It is your spirit. It is your flesh. It is your emotions. Because God says, I will lead you back to Jesus and I'll lead you back to the Word. He is a Holy Spirit who will always lead us to holiness. Can I have an amen? He will lead us in truth, who proceeds from the Father. He will bear witness about me, and you also will bear witness because you've been with me from the beginning. Oh, turn over to John chapter 16 and beginning at verse 7, and we read there. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is for your advantage that I go away, for I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin. How many have unsaved loved ones? You know what the ministry of the Holy Spirit is? It's to convict them, to go after them, Not for you to go after them, not for you to be the sheriff, not for you to be the policeman of your unsaved loved ones, but you are to pray, Holy Spirit, go to them and convict them. Show them their fault. Show them their sin. Show them where they've messed up. It is the job of the Holy Spirit. Why do we need saturation? I pray that when our homes are so saturated with the presence of God that when your unsaved loved ones come in, you don't have to say one word. You don't have to have 15,000 plaques on the wall about as for me and my house will serve the Lord. But the moment they walk in, they sense the presence of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit draws them. I pray that when people come into our campuses, it's not about the flags and the pews and the music. It's about the presence of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will convict them, will convict them that God, you go after them and draw them by your love. He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment of sin, because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you. I don't need some fortune teller to tell me. I don't need some wacky prophet telling me what I need to do. When you are saturated by the Spirit of God will lead you and guide you. He will show you which way. The steps of a righteous man or woman are ordered of the Lord. He will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he'll tell you things to come. He will always glorify me, for he will take out of what is mine and declare it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore I said that he will take of mine and declare it to you. If Jesus spent that much time teaching his disciples about the Holy Spirit, doesn't it make sense that it should be important to the church today? That it should be something that we need and something that we desire and something that we understand. We need to ask ourselves, are we saturated in the Holy Spirit? It was a prophetic experience, but quickly it was also a powerful experience. That word power, that he says you shall be clothed with power or baptized with power, comes from the Greek word dunamis, which means dynamic and dynamite. God wants us to live a dynamic life in the Holy Spirit. It says in Luke 24:49, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. On this cold day, the newscasters were saying that you need to have many layers on, layer up. You know what? There's a lot of Christians who are going around in their birthday suits spiritually. They're not clothed. They're not clothed to handle the attacks that are coming against you. There are things that are coming against our life, and we're walking around, we're not clothed. I mean, when I left early this morning, I had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm cold all the time. I had 7 layers on to beat the cold. I had my face covered. I had my hands covered. I had 7 layers on. I still have 4 layers on right now. The reality is I need to be layered up. Friends, we need to be layered up in the power of the Holy Spirit, because the enemy comes in like a flood. And if you're running around in your spiritual birthday suit, you will never be able to stand out when the winds of adversity come against you. And he says, I want you to be clothed with the power of the Holy Spirit. It says in Acts 1:8, but you were receive power. He was talking to the church. He was talking to Christians. He's not talking to the world. He said, I want you to be saturated and clothed with the presence of God. For as you look at the process of saturation, first of all, at salvation, the Holy Spirit comes to live and dwell within you. You got to understand that this morning, that if you're a child of God, the Spirit lives in you. That the Holy Spirit lives in you. He's not Casper, the friendly ghost out there somewhere. Oh, I got to go to this place to find the Holy Spirit. or I gotta go down to Florida to get the Holy Spirit, or I gotta go over to California to get. You don't have to go anywhere to get the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit lives and dwells in the child of God. When I am a child of God, His Spirit lives within me. What a hope that gives to me, that I'm a new creation. The old is gone and the new is come. And when the enemy whispers that you're not saved, I can say I am saved, not because of what I feel. I'm saved because of what God's Word says, that I am the temple of the Holy Spirit. But at Pentecost, I get empowered to live a dynamic and a daring life. Friends, look what happens in Acts chapter 2, verses 2 to 4. Suddenly, I love that word, suddenly. Suddenly, they were praying, they were expecting, they were in the upper room, but suddenly a sound came from heaven. The 120 believers were waiting with expectancy. They knew what Jesus said, that I'm going to give you the gift of the Holy Spirit. They didn't know it, but suddenly, when friends, they had no idea what was going to happen. They didn't know what to look for. But what happens? Suddenly, the Holy Spirit shows up. And you never know when the Spirit's going to show up. If you're walking in obedience to Him, by faith, you can suddenly experience His presence. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven. A sound. Why a sound? Another translation puts it this way. It was a strong wind of a gale force. In the upper room, it was a sound from heaven that filled the upper room. It was not wind. It was the sound of wind. It was not wind, but it had the sound. It sounded like wind. This sound of wind was totally supernatural. It was not man-made. It was not a gimmick. Today they tell you in the church, you want to grow your church, you got to have all the right stuff, the right gimmicks. You got to have the right music, the right lights, the right ambiance. You got to give people what they want, and they will work the Spirit up. No, there was a sound from heaven. You know why there was a sound from heaven? It's because God wanted to get their attention. God wants to get ICC's attention. And when we say, God, I want to be saturated with your presence, God is going to give us a sound from heaven. Not the sound of man, but a sound from heaven. It was a sound that was totally supernatural. It was not the gimmick. Some commentary said it this way. The Spirit wanted to get the attention of everyone in the upper room, to get them ready so that they can have faith to believe that what was going to happen was from the Lord and was supernatural. And God wants to do the supernatural. But He must get our attention. How does He get our attention? Some of you are going through problems, you can't find an answer. God's trying to get your attention. When the doctor gives you bad news, God's trying to get your attention. God's trying to get your attention when you're spiritually cold and spiritually anemic. He's trying to get our attention. Friends, He wants us to know that it's not of man, but it's of the Spirit. It was a sound from heaven. It was not attributed to man. Friends, does God really have our attention? Friends, we just spent 40 days in prayer and fasting. And let me tell you, when the prayer level goes up, the enemy's level goes up as well. And you better be ready for the battle of your life, because the enemy doesn't want you to be saturated with the Spirit of God. But God is saying, I'm going to give you a sound from heaven. I'm going to speak to you. I'm going to get your attention. Because when I have your attention, your life is open to the work of God. Does He really have our attention? Or are we going to keep on doing the same old thing? See, God wants every believer to be saturated. But not only was there a sound, but there was an appearance. It says in verse 3, they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. Man, that sounds so hokey. It sounds so abnormal. What in the world is that talk? It doesn't talk and say that there was all these little fireballs that came in and sat on the 120. It says there was one fire that appeared and it came and broke up and went over everything. You know what that tells me? God is not looking for one superstar in the church. He's not looking for one. Well, we want all those up here filled. And I can live any way I want. Let me tell you, God wants to fill ICC, but it goes from the balcony to the back row, to the youth room, to the nursery, to the platform. He wants us all saturated with the presence of God. It's a single fire. It appeared and began to split and divide itself. The spiritual gift was not for one person, but it came and sat on every single one. There are no superstars in the kingdom of God. There are only those who say, I want to be saturated by the presence of the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit came and enabled them. But there was also an experience, not just the signs, not just the sound, not just the tongue, the fire, but in verse 4, and all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Friends, every believer, everyone was filled. Why? Because the Holy Spirit was outpoured. There are Christians that feel, I don't need the Holy Spirit. Man, I don't know how you can live a Christian life without the Holy Spirit. I don't know how you can live a Spirit-filled, saturated life unless you open your life to Him. Well, I don't need the baptism. I don't need the prayer language. That's not me. I'm not emotional. Friends, the Spirit is not about emotions. It's about saying, God, I need you. I want you. God, I can't make it on my own. I can't walk the spiritual life without you. Friends, Pentecost, number 3, is a personal experience. It's not just a denomination. It's not just what some churches believe, but God wants you to experience Him. I remember when I was a 16-year-old boy, and I was sitting in church in the fourth row, and when the speaker came and gave an altar call, a missionary was there, and he says, if you want to give your heart to God, you want to give your heart to ministry. I remember as a 16-year-old boy, I sat with all the other youth in that row, and I remember when I got up and I walked to an altar, and all I says, God, I'll give my life to you. Not salvation, I was already saved, but God, if you want to use me, I'll do whatever you want. You want me to be a missionary, I'll be a missionary. Whatever you want me to do, I will do it. And I remember I came and I knelt at an altar and I says, God, whatever you want to do in my life. And as I prayed, I received a personal experience of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. No one had to pray over me. I was in the church all my life for 16 years. But that night, I had a personal experience with the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you, no one can take that experience away from me. You can say, well, you can't back it up. I can back it up because I know what happened on that night. That night changed my life forever. And that's why I'm doing what I'm doing today, is because I had a personal experience. It doesn't matter what family says. It doesn't matter what religious people say. It's something that God did in my life. And God wants to give you an experience as well. And if God gave you the Holy Spirit, it must be for your good and for your benefit. Oh, quickly, let me give you a couple things in closing. Why do I need the baptism? Why do I need the saturation in my life? First of all, our minds need to be saturated by the Holy Spirit. Too many Christians have problems between their ears. They have too many voices speaking out to them. Their minds are all over the place. Their minds are not where God wants them to be. How many know that God's ways are much higher than our ways? And we don't have the answers for the troubles of this what people are facing. We're not smart enough to figure out God. We're not smart enough to know what to do with the crises of life. But John 14:26 says, the Holy Spirit shall teach you all things and bring things to your mind. Because when I'm saturated with the Word and I'm saturated with the Spirit, then I'm not going to think like the world. Too many Christians think just like the world. Now you got to ask people, are you a Christian? Oh yeah, I'm a Christian. Are you a practicing Christian? Do you practice Christianity? Do you practice the Word? Do we think like the world, or do we think like a child of our Heavenly Father? Do we think the Word? Do we say the Word when things come into our life? Do we think according to the flesh and walk around confused? Friends, let me tell you, our minds are a battlefield without the Holy Spirit. But God is not the author of confusion. And if you're confused, then you need to be saturated with the Spirit of God. For Paul said in Philippians 4:8, finally, brothers, think on these things. Whatever is true, How many of us think more to the false than we do to the true? First thing we think is negative. First thing we think of is something's wrong. God says, I want you to think what is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable. If anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Our minds are our own worst enemy, and God is not the author of confusion. Oh, the Holy Spirit not only wants to saturate our minds, but he wants to saturate our bodies. It says in Romans chapter 8, verse 11, if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells within you, he that raised up Jesus from the dead shall also quicken your mortal or your physical body. Man, when you're saturated with the presence of God, man, I talked to one dear sister this week who got a bad report from the doctor. She says, I'm great. I'm great. Man, how many Christians, the doctor says you got a ingrown toenail. Oh, my life is falling apart, Lord. This lady has cancer. I'm okay. I'm okay. God's a good father. See, God wants to quicken your mortal body. When the same spirit that raised Christ dwells within you, you can go through any situation because the spirit of the living God is in you. Friends, have you noticed our bodies are falling apart? They're decaying day by day. They're getting wrinkly, sagging, falling out, not as strong as they used to be. We're breaking down. We don't bounce back as quick as we used to. Man, maybe you have the disease called B. Baldness, bifocals, bulges, bursitis, bellies, and bunions. And you're saying, God, where are you? God wants to quicken your mortal body. And when you're saturated with the Spirit of God, you may go through cancer. But God says, my grace will be sufficient for you. And I will never leave you. And I will never forsake you. And that when your body is falling down, there is a God that says, when I am weak, that he is strong. And I'm not going to be overcome by cancer. I'm not going to overcome by heart disease or blood disease. I'm going to be a victorious Christian. Why? Because the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells within us. Oh, our spirits also need to be saturated. Not just our minds, not just our bodies, but our spirit. There are too many Christians who are depressed. Too many Christians who are walking around saying, man, everything's against me. How many Christians, their spirits are worn down. You need to be strengthened spiritually. Too many Christians are waiting for someone else to pat them on the back. They're waiting for some conference. They're waiting for some new book. They're waiting for some other guy to come and pray over them. Friends, let me tell you, thank God for other people praying for me. But I'm so glad the Holy Spirit lives within me. And he prays for me according to the will of God. And when I pray in my spirit, he lifts me up. He who speaks in a tongue, 1 Corinthians 14:4, edifies himself. Friends, God wants to saturate our minds. He wants to saturate our bodies. He wants to saturate our spirits. How do I do it? Jude verse 20 says, but you, dear friends, build yourselves up in your most holy faith. Build yourselves up. Build yourselves up. How you build yourself? Get into the word for yourself and pray in faith. And pray in the Holy Spirit. You say, man, I'm so depressed. Get into prayer. See, that's the fourth thing that he wants to saturate, our prayer life. He wants to saturate your prayer. Prayer is not rituals. You can stop playing. Prayer is not rituals. We just came through 40 days of prayer and fasting. Some participated, and some were just spectating. God wants to saturate our prayer life because there are things that happen in our lives that we can't do anything about. But I'm so glad that God says that you can pray in the Spirit. It says in Romans chapter 8 that Pastor Pablo mentioned before, there are times in life that we don't know how to pray. We're not smart enough. We don't have the answers. And it says that when we don't know how to pray, the Spirit that is within us prays in accordance with the will of God. The Spirit prays with groans and utterings. And when we don't know what to say with our natural mind, I'm so glad for the baptism of the Holy Spirit that prays through us and lifts us up and edifies us. Because the Holy Spirit wants to saturate. It says, if anyone needs wisdom, let him ask of God, and God will give it. Lord, saturate our prayer life. And lastly, he wants to saturate our worship. Our worship. Worship's not about singing. Worship's not coming to church and looking at the clock and saying, man, I gotta worship. No, worship is a lifestyle. Worship is not about emotions. And man, we gotta sing the right songs to get people in the mood. And we gotta do the right, you know, the right genre of music. And if we don't do it, then something. Let me tell you, when you worship God in spirit and in truth, it doesn't matter what's playing. It doesn't matter what songs we're singing. We worship in spirit and in truth, and we must hunger and thirst. I'm going to ask us to stand all over this place.